Hello and welcome to our presentation on Global Trends 2030. It is always a human desire to know what the future holds. But what will be the world looking like by 2030? The world of 2030 will be radically transformed from our world today. By 2030, no country, whether the United States, China, or any other large country, will be a hegemonic power. There's the power of individuals, diffusion of power among states and from states to informal networks will have a dramatic impact, largely reversing the historic rise of the West since 1750 and restoring Asia's weight in the global economy and ushering in a new era of democratization in the international and domestic level. In addition to individual empowerment and diffusion of power, it is believed that two other mega trends will shape our world out to 2030. These are demographic patterns, especially rapid aging, the growing resource demands, which are in the form of food and water, which might lead to scarcity. These trends, which are virtually certain, exist today, but during the next 15 to 20 years, they will gain much greater momentum. Underpinning the mega trends are the tectonic shifts, the critical changes to the key features of our global environment that will affect how the world works. Among these mega trends, as highlighted in our introduction, is individual empowerment. By 2030, it is understood that individual empowerment will accelerate owing to poverty reduction, growing of the global middle class, greater educational attainment, widespread of use of communication and manufacturing technologies. This will also have a shift that we can see in our healthcare advances. Diffusion of power. There will not be any hegemonic power. Power will shift to networks and coalitions in multipolar world. What of the demographic patterns? The demographic arc of instability will narrow. Economic growth will decline in aging countries. 60% of the world's population will live in urbanized areas. Thus, migration will increase. Food, water, and energy relationships. The demand for these resources will grow substantially owing to an increase in the global population. Tackling problems pertaining to one commodity will be linked to supply and demand of the other. Particularly when coming up to with these conclusions, there are some main game changers that will be considered. These include crisis-prone global economy. Will global volatility and imbalances among players with different economic interests result in collapse? Or will greater multipolarity lead to increased resilience in the global economic order? How about governance gap? Will governments and institutions be able to adapt fast enough to harness changes instead of being overwhelmed by it? Another game changer to consider is the potential for increased conflict. Will rapid changes and shift in power lead to more intrastate and interstate conflicts? How about the wider scope of regional instability? Will regional instability, especially in the Middle East and South Asia, spill over and create global insecurity? The impact of technology cannot be ruled out. Which brings a question: will the technological breakthroughs be developed in time to boost economic productivity and solve the problems caused by a growing world population, rapid urbanization, and climatic changes? All these important game changers need to be considered, and the answers to these give rise to the form. mega trains. Now to look at each mega trend as we look forward to the world of 2030, let's look at individual empowerment. How will it be like? Individual empowerment will accelerate substantially during the next 15 to 20 years owing to poverty reduction and a huge growth of the global middle class, greater educational attainment, and a better healthcare. The growth of the global middle class constitutes a tectonic shift. For the first time, a majority of the world's population will not be impoverished. And the middle classes will be the most important social and economic sector in the vast majority of countries around the world. Thus, what then do we consider ourselves? Where do we see ourselves at by 2030? Will this greater educational attainment have a great impact on our society today, especially the countries that are developing now? How about the healthcare sector? Are we going to see a widespread and even distribution of better health facilities? These are the things that we need to look into and see where we stand, even as developing countries. Mega trend number two, which is diffusion of power. The diffusion of power among countries will have a dramatic impact by 2030. Asia will surpass North America, Europe combined in terms of global power based on GDP, population size, military spending, and technological investment. China alone will probably have the largest economy, surpassing that of the United States a few years before 2030. In a tectonic shift, the health of a global economy increasingly will be linked to how well the developing world does, more so than the traditional West. In addition to China, India and Brazil, regional players such as Colombia, Indonesia, Nigeria, South Africa and Turkey will become especially important to the global economy. Megatrend number three. The demographic patterns. It is believed that the world of 2030, a world in which a growing global population will have reached somewhere close to 8.3 billion people, up from about 7.1 billion in 2012. These four demographic trends will fundamentally shape, although not necessarily determine, most countries' economic and political conditions and relations among nations. These trends are aging. A tectonic shift for both the West and increasingly most developing countries. A still significant but shrinking number of youthful societies and states, migration, which will increasingly be a cross-border issue, and the growing urbanization. How do we see ourselves in terms of demographic patterns? Owing to rapid urbanization in the developing world, the volume of urban construction for housing, office space, transport services over the next 40 years could roughly equal the entire volume of such construction to date in the world's history. Thus, we are seeing the growing need for more and more resource exploitation and a tactful approach to all the scarce resources. Where do we stand then as a nation? How about global trend number four? Food, water, and energy relationships. Demand for food, water, and energy will grow by an average of 42%, owing to an increase in the global population and the consumption pattern of an expanding middle class. Climate change will worsen the outcome for the availability of these critical resources. Climate change analysis suggests that the severity of existing weather patterns will intensify, with wet areas getting wetter and dry and arid areas becoming more so, as shown in the diagram. Much of the decline in precipitation will occur in the Middle East and Northern Africa, as well as Western and Central Asia, Southern Europe, Southern Africa, and the US Southwest. How then are we going to react to such a projection? Are we going to see a scramble for these resources? How are we going to adapt, even as a nation, as a developing nation? Are we harnessing on the much needed agricultural resources? As highlighted before, in coming up with these mega changes, a lot of game changers have to be considered. How about the crisis-prone global economy? In coming up with the mega trends, some critical game changers had to be considered. 1. The crisis-prone global economy. The international economy almost certainly will continue to be characterized by various regional and national economies moving at significantly different speeds, a pattern reinforced by the 2008 global financial crisis. Another major global economic crisis cannot be ruled out. Regardless of which solution is eventually chosen, progress will be needed on several fronts to restore stability. Earlier economic crises such as the 1930s Great Depression also hit when the age structure of many Western populations were relatively youthful, providing a demographic bonus during the post-war economic boom. However, such a bonus will not exist in any perspective recovery for Western countries. To compensate for drops in labor force growth, hoped for economic gains will have to come from growth in productivity. The United States is in a better position because its workforce is projected to increase during the next decade. But the US will still need to increase labor productivity to offset its slowly aging workforce. A critical question is whether technology can sufficiently boost economic productivity to prevent a long-term slowdown. Game changer number 2, the governance gap. The governance gap will continue to be the most pronounced at the domestic level and driven by rapid political and social changes. The advances during the past couple of decades in health, education, and income, which we expect to continue, if not accelerate in some cases, will drive new governance structures. The transition to democracy are much more stable and long-lasting when youth bulges begin in decline and incomes are higher. Currently, about 50 countries are in the awkward stage between autocracy and democracy, with the largest number concentrated in sub-Saharan Africa, Southeast and Central Asia, and the Middle East and North Africa. Both social scientist theory and recent history, the color revolutions and the Arab Spring, support the idea that with the maturing age structures and rising income, political liberalization and democracy will advance. However, many countries will still be zigzagging their way through the complicated demographic democratization process during the next 15 to 20 years. Countries moving from autocracy to democracy have a proven track record of instability. Game changer number 3, potential for increased conflict. there is need to be cautious about the prospects of for declines in the number and intensity of intrastate conflicts. And interstate conflicts remain a possibility. Intrastate conflicts have regularly increased in countries with a maturing overall population than contain a political dissonant. Youthful ethnic minority. Intrastate conflicts have gradually increased. Game changer number three, potential for increased conflict. There is need to be cautious about the prospects for declines in a number of and intensity of intrastate conflicts. And interstate conflicts remain a possibility. The intrastate conflicts have gradually increased in countries with a mature overall population that contains a political dissonant, youthful ethnic minority. Strife involving ethnic Kurds in Turkey, Shia in Lebanon, are examples of such situations. Looking forward, the potential for conflict to occur in sub-Saharan Africa is likely to remain high even after some of the region's countries graduate into a more intermediate age structure because of the probable large number of ethnic and tribal minorities that will remain more youthful than the overall population. Thus, insufficient natural resources such as water and arable land in many of the same countries that will have disproportionately levels of youth and young men increase the risk of intra-state conflicts breaking out, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa and South and East Asian countries, including China and India. How about the wide scope of regional instability? The regional dynamics in several different theaters during the next couple of decades will have the potential to spill over and create global insecurity and crisis. South Asia faces a series of internal and external shocks during the next 15 to 20 years. Low growth, rising food prices, and energy shortages will pose stiff challenges to government in Pakistan and Afghanistan. Youth bulges are large. When these youth bulges are combined with a slowly moving economy, they portend increased instability. Game changer number five, the impact of new technologies. Information technology is entering the big data era. Process power and data storage are becoming almost free. Networks and the cloud will prove global access. Networks and the cloud will provide global access and pervasive services. Social media and cybersecurity will be the large new markets. This growth and diffusion will prevent significant challenges for government and societies, which must find ways to capture the benefits of new IT technologies while dealing with the new trends that these technologies present. As companies in IT, what then can we? As companies in IT, what then can we do to harness these developments in technology? Are we going to see the high demand for IT gadgets? Are we going to see the high demand for data? We need then to harness on these opportunities that are presented by the growing era of new technologies. Information technology-based solutions to maximize citizens' economic productivity and quality of life while minimizing resource consumption and environmental degradation will be a critical issue in ensuring the viability of megacities. It is our desire and everyone's desire to know more about the future. And we hope this presentation presented a green light into how our world will look like by 2030. Will the world be destroyed? Or are we going to see a progressive world by 2030?